In English as well. Okay, the next talk will be in English as well. A lot of data about the individual is collected within the EU. For example, our fingerprints on passports and soon on other identification documents. Creepy enough, but in India, they have this large database called Aadhaar with biometrics and demographic data about over a billion people. Kim Arora, a journalist from India and a guest researcher at WZB, will tell us a lot of creepy things.
Hi, I'm Kim, and today I'll be talking about Aadhaar and privacy. I'm doing a very short an introduction to what Aadhaar is and the kind of challenges and how it has been challenged in court. I don't know. Before I start, can I have a quick temperature check? How many of us have heard about Aadhaar or read about it? Oh, quite a few of you. Okay, great, 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 excellent. So you probably already know that it was it's a biometric ID program. It was challenged in the Indian Supreme Court, and there was a recent ruling which struck down or deleted certain sections of the Aadhaar Act. It's been a long and quite a tumultuous story, so I'm gonna go through it step by step. Let's get started with first the very basics. We'll start with, for those of us who don't know what Aadhaar is, it is a biometrics-based proof of identity, and it consists of a 12-digit number, and it is linked to your biometric details like your 10 fingerprints, iris scans, and it also carries a photograph. And the project is run and managed by this government agency called the Unique Identification Authority of India, or the UIDAI. You are going to hear this name a lot in this presentation, so keep that in mind. And it is meant for Indian citizens as well as those who have been residents in India for more than 182 days. So if you were to move to India and live there for more than 6 months, you could potentially apply for an Aadhaar. The project was launched 10 years ago. And at the time, the stated objective was to reduce leakages in the public welfare system. So if I were to receive food grains as a ration from the government, I could receive this through Aadhaar. And the problem that they were trying to solve over there was that very often there was either double drawing or corruption in the system, or for some if there were middlemen pilfering food grains, for example. So they wanted to cut all of that out and make the process smoother. And also, a lot of times what would happen would be the beneficiaries of these government welfare schemes would be from marginalized sections of society. So very often it would be difficult for them to have a streamlined sort of identity which they can use. So driver's license, probably they wouldn't have a passport anyway, very few have that. So they wanted like one ID to rule them all, so to speak. You know, so have just one streamlined ID for everything instead of showing your passport and then in conjunction with that, your election ID card, your voter ID card, and so on and so forth. From 2009 to now, almost the entire country has been enrolled in the Aadhaar program as we speak today. And that happened because it was, as the project, the ambit of the project, as time went by, the ambit of the project sort of widened. So it wasn't just welfare schemes. Soon enough, you needed it to file your income tax returns. You couldn't do that without the Aadhaar. And as time went by, it was briefly made mandatory for opening a new bank account, and people were also being asked to link their existing bank accounts with the Aadhaar. This was, of course, challenged in court, and then that condition no longer stands. It was also made mandatory for buying a new phone connection. For example, if I were to buy a new SIM card, say a new Vodafone SIM card, I would need to offer my Aadhaar as a know your customer compliance. I don't know what you call it here, but like an eKYC compliance. So I would have to give in my Aadhaar and link my phone number to that as well. So there was a time in the middle when this hadn't been struck down by the court that people were getting repeated SMSs and emails saying that, okay, this is the deadline, link your phone number to Aadhaar. This is your deadline, link your bank account to Aadhaar. A lot of people held out, a lot of people gave in, and it went on. So the opposition to Aadhaar came on various grounds. There was one of the chief, of course, privacy was the chief opposition, chief issue that people raised. There were also other operational issues like biometrics not being reliable enough for somebody who's trying to get something from the public distribution system. So for example, if a beneficiary is, for example, a manual laborer, which would very often happen. So if they're working, say, in a stone quarry or in a field, their fingerprints would not be reliable enough indicators of who they are. And then as the stated objective of making it an inclusionary project, it ended up becoming exclusionary, because if they're not being able to authenticate themselves, how do they draw those benefits then? So that became a problem. But today, I'm out of all of these, I'm going to focus on the privacy challenge. And before I start with the nitty-gritties of exactly what the legal challenge was, what the rights-based challenge was, I want to go into quickly a few case studies of data being leaked or stolen or compromised in other ways so that we have an idea of what we're talking about. So there was this very, very recent case. This is 20th February, this story. It actually broke earlier. This is a follow-up, but what happened was it was discovered that a enrollment officer, a person who's supposed to enroll people into the Aadhaar program, who will take your fingerprints and then generate an Aadhaar for you, his biometrics were discovered to be stolen. And the person himself found out after the software sort of blocked him because it detected unusual activity. It's like it was showing one authentication by him in one state, and a few hours later it's happening in another state. So obviously there was something wrong there. And it was discovered that the biometrics were in fact stolen. And this is not the first time that this had happened, but a similar case, a gang of people busting, a gang was busted in 2017. They were also stealing biometrics. This was in the state of Uttar Pradesh. Another story that some of you might be familiar with, because it made international headlines, was this one, where a reporter was able to buy access to a software from which she could access all Aadhaar details. And she bought it for 500 rupees, that's €6.20. And she made the payment through, she never met the person, she made the payment through a digital wallet app. It was the link was sent to her and she set it up and then she had access to everything. This again became a huge, huge story, and this happened while the Aadhaar was being challenged in the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court was still hearing all the petitions that had challenged it. The reporter ended up getting, she had a police complaint filed against her because there was no distinction between a whistleblower and a person actually breaking the law. So now these were not, these cases are not standalone by any means. There were quite a few breaches through the years. And how these breaches ended up happening was because of the data being seeded with various agencies or government departments or even phone companies for that matter. This example that you see over here, this was a telephone company that had used, a mobile phone company that had used Aadhaar to give SIM cards to people, and they'd come up with a popular phone plan which was really cheap, and therefore people lined up to get these, and they just had to sort of offer their Aadhaar and there they had it. And of course the data was not stored in a very secure manner, which is why it was leaked. And obviously this, again, a lot of government websites also failed to mask the data well, which is why a talented enough scraper could get access to it. Now what happens with various databases existing like this is it opens up a scope for triangulation and profiling. And that is something that it shouldn't take Edward Snowden to bring up, but it did. And what I want to draw your attention to here is why I picked this one is because it also has a response from a message from the UIDI, the nested tweet that you see there. It says Aadhaar is an identifier, not a profiling tool. It does not keep any information about bank accounts, shares, mutual funds, property details, health records, etc., which is correct. The central database does not. It is, and that has been the UIDI's standing argument throughout the breaches that I showed you, that it does not, it says that it does not store profiling information. And it has always maintained, whenever these reports do come up, that it is not a breach, is what they say. They constantly say that it is not a breach, Aadhaar is completely secure, it is not a breach, Aadhaar is secure, it's unhackable, is what so what they've said. Now the thing is, this is happening because the people who are holding this data, they are not holding it securely enough. And then where does the accountability then lie? And before I move to the next section, I want to, because I'm talking about Aadhaar and vulnerable data, I cannot do a talk about that without introducing you to this gentleman. He goes by the name Elliot Alderson on Twitter. That's not his real name, it's an alias. He's a French security researcher and he sort of found a hobby with the UIDI. And he has been quite sincerely going through all the databases that he can find and point out the vulnerabilities that he can. So if you are interested in how this works, I would recommend following this person and checking out how he does things. But he himself too, there have been a couple of big breaches that he actually brought light to. And while the UIDI obviously maintained that the data is secured, it did force some agencies to either lock down or try to secure the data in some way or the other if the breach was big enough. So for example, very recently he discovered that a state oil company was had not masked Aadhaar data securely enough, and he was able to access, I think the projection was potentially 6.7 million people's data was vulnerable. I think he was able to get access to a lot less, but the projection was 6.7 million. And so that was the sort of scenario that we are operating in while Aadhaar is still being challenged in court. Now, what were the legal safeguards for this program before it began and while it was in operation? There were limited provisions under the Aadhaar Act, which, as you can see, was introduced in 2016. The program itself started in 2009, so that's already some enough years of gap. And this act was recently amended to make way for, as a means to make room for some of the things that the Supreme Court had ruled on, but then again, there were other problems with it, which I'll come to later. In the absence of the Aadhaar Act, of course, there were penalties for lapse of security by private players under the Information Technology Act. As for a data protection regulation, India does not have one as yet. There is a data protection bill which was released last year, and it is not yet tabled in Parliament, but it also comes up with certain safeguards, which again I will come to later in context with Aadhaar, how it ties in. So right now Aadhaar is operating without a data protection regulation in place, which is something that civil society had challenged, that you know, you can't be operating, you can't be collecting data on a mass scale like this without a data protection regulation in place. Meanwhile, the kind of tech fixes that the UIDI came to try to bring in to avoid these kind of widespread Aadhaar numbers being leaked or published was that they came up with this thing called the virtual ID, which is a temporary sort of token that would be generated and sent to your mobile, so that in your interface with a service provider, then you use your virtual ID and not your actual Aadhaar number. And then it doesn't, then you limit your risk, basically. And the other thing that they came up with was a QR code with which you can do an offline authentication. And That's very recent, so we're yet to see how that case is building up and how that's being accepted. The legal challenge to the program, so there were 31 challenges to the program, and the Supreme Court of India sort of heard them together. If anyone wants to look it up, it's under K.S. Puttaswamy versus Union of India. And the primary arguments from the petitioners were obviously on privacy violations and the potential for surveillance that a mass data collection drive like this entails, because you're building a honeypot, so it's vulnerable. And there was obviously they took great exception to mandatory linking of Aadhaar to mobile phone numbers and bank accounts and birth and death certificates and all of that. And all of that was challenged. And this is where things get interesting, because the Aadhaar case actually, I mean, in challenging the program on the basis of privacy, it actually got India an acknowledged fundamental right to privacy. And how does that work? So when the arguments in court started, the government actually argued that the petitioner's argument does not hold because the right to privacy does not exist. And this obviously is, you have to understand, happening in a context when the Snowden revelations have already happened in 2013. People are more tech savvy, they understand how privacy works, and they don't want to share too much data with social networks even. So there is some amount of awareness already in the system about why it is important and what it can do, what lack of privacy can do. So the Supreme Court actually referred this matter to a larger bench, and then they said, okay, we'll stop this for now. So first we ascertain whether privacy is a fundamental right or not. Because so far in case law, privacy was read as a component of other fundamental rights, but not acknowledged as a fundamental right as such. So there was some amount of ambiguity there. So they wanted to be absolutely sure, and it was a different set of hearings that happened to ascertain whether privacy is a fundamental right or not. And it was. And the Aadhaar hearings continued, and a year after the right to privacy was the Supreme Court ruled in favor of the right to privacy in 2017, and September 2018 was when the Aadhaar judgment finally came out, and the Supreme Court said that, well, the act is constitutional, what you said about the program being unconstitutional is not true. It would be unfair to strike down the program altogether, because there are people already enrolled in it, already trying to get benefits out of it, so it would be unfair on them, so that's not on. And also they found it to be not violative of privacy. And to be fair, there were certain use cases where Aadhaar was helpful to people. For example, there was a case where a young boy, he was speech impaired, and he ran away from home and was lost and was taken in by a shelter, and they couldn't find his parents, obviously, because couldn't speak, couldn't find his family. So at the shelter they thought, okay, now this guy is with us, let's enroll him into Aadhaar, let's see what we can do for him further. And sure enough, as soon as he gave his biometrics, they discovered that, well, he's already enrolled, and then they were able to trace his family and reunite with him with the family. But then again, there are other cases of your data breaches, and there are people who have actually been able to forge identities with Aadhaar, which was completely counter to the whole point of Aadhaar. It was supposed to be biometrics-based identity, which cannot be forged. And part of the problem also was that, so a lot of times when you read about Aadhaar, you might, in colloquial terms, you might hear it or read about it being referred to as an Aadhaar card. So a card is sure enough, I think I had a picture here somewhere. Yeah, it looks like this. It is issued to you. You don't really need it for authentication. For authentication, what you need is, of course, your fingerprints and the number. But the card is also issued. It's like a longish thing, but you can also sort of cut it off from there, so it becomes like a smaller Ausweis kind of thing. There are people who've been able to forge these cards as well. So there was a case where I don't remember the state this happened in, but there was a man who was able to just you can also print your Aadhaar card yourself at home. So he was able to just switch the picture. And a lot of times in places there are people not actually authenticating you. So if you show them the Aadhaar card, it goes. So for example, if I'm in a train and they come checking for tickets, and typically what they do is they take your ticket and they'll check ticket against an ID. A lot of times people just carry their driver's license. They also accept Aadhaar now. So obviously your ticket checker is not going to go around with a POS machine taking fingerprints from everyone. So they're like, okay, Aadhaar card, it goes. So he was able to, this man was able to get a credit card in a dead man's name, happened to be some dead relative, and thought he would make a killing, but then he was caught, obviously, when the bills were unpaid. And then it came to light how this happened. And there are several cases like this where there have been serious security lapses because of people being able to forge Aadhaar. So on that count as well, it hasn't performed to the extent that it was expected or intended to be. After the court ruled, the court judgment came out, there were certain provisions in the Aadhaar Act which were struck down. One of which was authentication by private bodies. So it said, okay, you're making this mandatory for phone companies or whatever, no can do, this is not on, and private companies should not be holding Aadhaar data, and this is violative of privacy. This is unconstitutional, so we can't have that. And there was also earlier no provision for a person to complain against the UIDI. There was a provision in the Aadhaar Act which said only the UIDI can complain against the UIDI. So obviously there was no accountability in place. That provision was struck down. And there was also a provision which said that authorities can disclose Aadhaar data to the government in cases of national security, given that the government official should be of rank joint secretary and above. This was also read down, and they said that the rank needs to be higher because you can't expect somebody to, you know, deal with this thing when national security is concerned, because it might lead to abuse. Nonetheless, this is a non-comprehensive list, of course. There were a bunch of other cases where it was also struck down. They said that you can't ask for it in terms of school admissions. Schools can't be asking for it. And they also said that nobody should suffer for not having an Aadhaar. So right now it is still required for government subsidies, but in case my Aadhaar authentication fails because of illness or other reasons, because I've been doing manual labor and my fingerprints are not clear enough, I should not be turned away by a welfare granting authority. I should still be given my food grain or whatever I'm entitled to. And I should be allowed to give an alternative identity to assert my identity. It is still required for income tax returns. And because of this, there are now review petitions in the Supreme Court about this case, because they want, the civil society is of course not entirely happy with the kind of judgment that has come in. Of course, they're happy with the provisions that have been struck down, but they think that there's more that can be done. So where are we now? There are 5 review petitions at last count. And the data protection bill is yet to be discussed in parliament. It's not yet made it to parliament. Interestingly, about 5 days ago, there were amendments that were introduced to the Aadhaar Act. And these were introduced by an ordinance, which became a controversial issue. And among the various amendments that were introduced, one was that private bodies were allowed to use Aadhaar for KYC, given that the customer was offering it voluntarily. So in this case, a phone company should be able to accept Aadhaar if I want to give it to them. This is interesting because the virtual ID that I told you about, which is generated earlier, the one that masks it, it is delivered to your phone. So unless your Aadhaar is linked to your phone, you won't receive it. So then there's a trade-off again. And the other thing was that deletion of Authentication logs was also limited, so they introduced another provision for that. So there are this ordinance was turned out to be controversial because the way the Aadhaar Act itself was also introduced was also mired in controversy. It was introduced as a money bill, which does not require the approval of the upper house of parliament. It's enough to pass it in the lower house. So this is also being challenged, and great exception has been taken to the fact that it has been passed as an ordinance. As for the program right now, the money continues to pour in. The Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation has actually funded a World Bank program to take the Aadhaar approach to other countries. They want to replicate the project elsewhere. And Bill Gates has publicly spoken in favor of Aadhaar, saying that it is not a threat to privacy. So this is obviously something that will keep developing as we go forward. And for those of you who want to follow this with what happens, here is a list, again, non-comprehensive. On Twitter, you obviously can follow the UIDAI for official communication and another bunch of people and organizations who are following this very, very closely and tweet about it very routinely. Of course, you can follow the news as well. But if you want more real-time information, you can follow these people. Other scholars, researchers, and experts that you can follow for a more principles-based and a more discourse and narrative-based analysis of what is happening with Aadhaar and what needs to be done. There's Usha Ramanathan, Ritika Kheda, and Gautam Bhatia who've written extensively about it. And yeah, that's about it.
Thank you, Kim. Are there any questions about Aadhaar?
So fingerprints are a terrible idea in terms of security. Do they think about introducing other types of biometric proofs? And do you challenge the idea of having a central ID?
Yes, so the Aadhaar does capture iris scans as well, in addition to fingerprints. Sorry, what was the second question? Yeah, the challenge to having a central database, you mean? Yes, that was challenged, but the privacy advocates and activists in this area, they have said that having a central database is a horrible idea because it's just a honeypot.
Yeah, just a quick question. How's the time frame for the data protection law that is still in parliament?
It's not. I can't say. Frankly, no. It hasn't been tabled in Parliament, so I can't really say when it will be heard, when it will be discussed. But maybe another 4 to 5 months, perhaps. But again, that's a calculated guess, not a definitive thing that I can promise you.
Okay, another question.
Is it known by now where? On what servers, on what server farms, whatever, where all the data is stored by government, by UIDAI? Because I think before it was not known what is stored where, by whom, and how it is, where it finds itself physically, so to speak. Is that known by now? Is it possible to audit?
Possible to audit?
Yeah.
The UIDAI is only open to a financial audit, unfortunately, and not to a code audit, not yet at any rate. But yeah, it is known that there is a central identities data repository which exists, and that is where all the central database of all the seated information is.
Thank you, Kim. Jemand von der Privacy Week wollte